In this video, we extend the idea of position, velocity, and acceleration to higher dimensions. Everything we do in this video is given in two dimensions, but all the formulas could just be amended with a z-coordinate or k-hat term to extend to three dimensions. So in the picture, we're looking at a trajectory or path of an object in two dimensions, and we've labeled two moments in time on the curve, t1 and t2. We start with how to define the position of the object, and it turns out that the best way to do it is to label the position of an object by using a vector pointing from the origin to the location of the object, like this. So there's r1, the position at time 1, and r2, the position at time 2, and anywhere in between, we could write a position vector as a function of time for some arbitrary moment in time t. And so in this view, as a particle travels from t1 to t2, we're actually watching a position vector rotate and grow. As it continues to point at the location of the object for each moment in time. And after defining positions as vectors, the change in position, or displacement, keeps its old definition from one dimension. And we can write delta r is r2 minus r1. And then we recall that a vector difference has a nice geometric interpretation. When I write down r2 minus r1, I can visualize that by putting the tails of the two vectors in the same place. Well, that's already done because they're coming from the origin. And that vector difference points from the head of the second vector in the difference to the head of the first. In other words, it's a vector pointing from the head of r1 to the head of r2. And this makes a lot of sense for a displacement vector. It simply points from the initial position to the final position. So it tells us the total direction the object moved and exactly how far it went. Now we can put each of these position vectors into component form. We could write r1 equals x1 I hat plus y1 j hat, where the coordinates of this original point are x1, y1. And we can write r2 equals x2 I hat plus y2 j hat, where those are the final coordinates, x2 and y2. And then we expand the displacement into components, and we combine like terms. And I get an x2 minus x1 I hat plus a y2 minus y1 j hat. And finally, we can put this back into delta notation using the fact that delta always means final minus initial, or the second coordinate minus the first. And I can write this as delta x I hat plus delta y j hat. So our displacement vector in two dimensions is really just given by the x displacement in the I hat direction added to the y displacement in the j hat direction. Now that we have displacement, we consider how to define average velocity in a two-dimensional space. And the definition is the same as it was in one dimension. It's the displacement during some time interval divided by how long it takes. So in the picture at the left, we have a picture of our standard displacement vector pointing from the initial to final position. And that has a length measured in meters. And when I divide that by delta t, I get meters per second. And the average velocity is a vector. I'll just put the vector hat on there real quick. And it points in exactly the same direction as the displacement vector, because delta t is just a scalar, so it can change the length of the original vector of delta r, but it can't change the direction. So the length of the velocity vector really depends on how fast the object got from point A to point B. But we'll just put it into the picture like this, pointing in the same direction as the original displacement vector. And we can expand the displacement vector into its components and distribute that 1 over delta t to both terms individually. And when we do that, we discover that the coefficient of I hat in the average velocity vector is just the average x velocity. That's given by delta x divided by delta t, a change in the x coordinate divided by how long it took. So we can call that vx bar, I hat, and then a vy bar, j hat. Now, just like we did in one dimension, we can obtain the instantaneous velocity vector by finding the average velocity over a very small time interval. And the idea here is that if we let the time interval become small enough, the velocity vector doesn't have time to change. So for example, the average velocity over 1 nanosecond would then become a very good definition of instantaneous velocity. So we're going to compute the instantaneous velocity in this case at the time t1, and geometrically this limiting process that I'm talking about is it will compute the average velocity on t1 to t2 by taking the displacement vector and then dividing by the amount of time it took to get between those two points, and I get an average velocity vector, same as we've already done. And then I consider a displacement vector that's a little bit closer. So we're moving T2 in closer to T1. And we compute the displacement vector. And we divide by the amount of time it took to get between those points. Again, the length of the displacement vector is getting shorter as the time interval also becomes shorter. And I've got a new average velocity. And I continue like this, letting T2 become closer and closer and closer to T1. And I keep computing that displacement vector, dividing by the time interval separating those two points. So one thing to notice here is that when that time interval becomes sufficiently small, the velocity vector that I compute out of this becomes tangential to the trajectory, and that's an important thing to remember. Instantaneous velocity is always tangential to the trajectory. So this thing can be expressed as a limit, and I'm gonna write it this way first. It's the limit as delta t goes to zero, so the time interval size goes to zero, of the average velocity. But we can put the average velocity in its component form. And you might be comfortable getting to the conclusion from this point, but just to make it extra clear what we're looking at, I'm going to change the limit. Instead of it being in terms of a delta t, I'm going to write it as the limit as T2 goes to T1. So that second time we were looking at, T2 is getting really, really close to the original time, T1. And then we'll expand our delta x and our delta t as a T2 minus T1. And similar for the y coordinate. And this is the moment that I realize the coefficients of these unit vectors are actually derivatives. So that coefficient of I hat, that's the time derivative of x evaluated at t1. And the coefficient of j hat is the time derivative of y evaluated at t1. So this is a really cool result. All we have to do to get the velocity vector is take that original position vector and take the time derivative of each of its components. And instead of writing it specifically in terms of a t1, I'd like to write it in general. That the velocity vector at any moment in time is simply the time derivative of the components of the position vector. And sometimes it's useful to write this in terms of the velocity components. So I could write it as vx I hat plus vy j hat, where vx is just the instantaneous velocity in the x direction, vy is the instantaneous velocity in the y direction. So as a quick check on our understanding, we'll work a short example. In this example, we're given the position function for a particle explicitly in terms of t. So the position is given by t squared minus 3 I hat plus a 0.5 t cubed plus 2t multiplied by j hat. And we want to get the average velocity on the time interval 0 to 2. And the average velocity is the change in the position vector divided by the change in time. And so that'll be given by r of 2 minus r of 0 over 2 minus 0. And then we need to get r of 2 and r of 0 by subbing in those t values. So r of 2, and I get from my first component 2 squared minus 3, which is 1, so I get an I hat there. And then in my second component, I would have half of 2 cubed, that's 4, plus a 2 times 2, that gives me a total of 8, j hat. And then I subtract r of 0. When I sub in t equals 0, I get a negative 3 I hat, plus a 0, j hat. And that's all divided by the width of the time interval, which was 2. I distribute that minus sign in the numerator and combine like terms. And I get 4 I hat plus 8 J hat divided by 2. And finally, I divide the 2 out of this and I get 2 I hat plus 4 J hat. And I really should finish by putting units on my answer. That's 2 meters per second I hat plus 4 meters per second J hat. And what this means is that this particle was, on average, moving 2 meters per second to the right and 4 meters per second up on the time interval 0 to 2. In part B, I want the instantaneous velocity at t equals 1 second. So I need to find the velocity function, and that's the time derivative of the position vector. So I just differentiate each of the coefficients of the unit vectors with respect to time. This gives me a 2t I hat for the x component. And then for the y component, when I differentiate t cubed to bring the 3 in front, subtract 1 from the exponent, I get 1.5 t squared. And then the derivative of 2t is just 2. And I've got a 1.5t squared plus 2 times j hat. Now I just evaluate the instantaneous velocity function at t equals 1. And I've got 2 I hat plus 3.5 or 3.5 j hat. And again, I really should express this with units on it. So 2 meters per second I hat plus 3.5 meters per second j hat. So at that moment in time, the particle is moving exactly 2 meters per second to the right, and simultaneously 3.5 meters per second upward. So naturally, the next thing to do is to define average acceleration and learn how to compute it. And then we'll take a small time limit and come up with a definition for instantaneous acceleration. And average acceleration retains the same definition from the one-dimensional case. It's a change in velocity divided by a change in time. In other words, an average rate of change in a velocity. But this time it's a velocity vector. So what do we do geometrically? We would have to look at what's the velocity at t1, and I'll just call that v1. And then we'd look at what's the velocity at t2, and I'll call that v2. And of course, delta v in this expression for average acceleration, that's v2 minus v1. So that's a vector difference, and the way I can compute that geometrically again is by moving the tails of the two vectors into the same position. So I slide v2 over here and put the tail in the same place as the tail of v1. And the vector difference then would point from the head of v1 to the head of v2. There's my delta v for the given time interval. Then I divide by the length of the time interval, which rescales that vector but does not change its direction. And I've got my average acceleration vector. And then if we want to extend this to instantaneous acceleration, we just take a small time limit again. So it's the same idea where if I compute the average acceleration over a smaller and smaller and smaller time interval, eventually the average acceleration becomes a really good definition of instantaneous acceleration at a moment in time. So again, we imagine moving T2 closer and closer and closer to T1. And we keep repeating this process where we compute the velocity vector at each of those points in time. We take the vector difference and then we divide by delta T. And I'll go ahead and write this in the delta notation first. But things become more recognizable if I write it as a limit as T2 goes to T1. And then we can split V2 and V1 into their components. And then we gather like terms. And again, we recognize time derivatives in these coefficients. So my end result is that the instantaneous acceleration vector at a time T1 is given by the time derivative of the x component of the instantaneous velocity vector multiplied by I hat, and then a time derivative of the y component of the instantaneous velocity vector evaluated at T1 multiplied by J hat. And then we generalize to any time t, not just t1, and our acceleration vector is given by, again, taking the time derivatives of the instantaneous velocity vector components. This could also be written as a second time derivative of the position vector components. So I could write x double prime of t, I hat, plus a y double prime of t, J hat. So we'll practice these concepts by working a short example. And in this one, again, I have the same position function given to me, but this time I want the average acceleration on the time interval t equals 0 to t equals 1. So remember, to get average acceleration, I've got to take the change in the velocity vector and divide by the amount of time that went by. This means I need to find the instantaneous velocity vector as a first step. And v of t is the time derivative of the position vector. So I just differentiate each of the components, and this gives me 2t I hat plus a 1.5 t squared plus 2 all multiplied by j hat. And then I can evaluate what's the velocity at t equals 1 second. So I sub in t equals 1 and I get 2 I hat plus 3.5 j hat. So there's my instantaneous velocity when t is equal to 1. Then I have to compute that when t is equal to 0. And the x component for v of 0 is 0 because I subbed in t equals 0. The y component is just a 2 j hat. So my average acceleration vector, again, that's a difference between my final and initial velocities. And that's divided by the width of the time interval, which happens to be 1 second in this case. And combining like terms, I get 2 I hat plus 1.5 j hat. And I should express this with units on it. And if I go back to my original definition of average acceleration, I have a delta v in the numerator, so that has units of meters per second on each of the components. And I'm dividing by a delta t measured in seconds. And that means I get the correct units of meters per second squared on each of my components in the final answer. So that's 2 meters per second squared, I hat, plus 1.5 meters per second squared, j hat. So on average over this time interval, the particle was accelerating at 2 meters per second per second in the plus x direction and 1.5 meters per second in the plus y direction. Now I want my instantaneous acceleration at t equals 0. So I start with my instantaneous velocity function and I just take the next derivative. Again, the acceleration function is given by differentiating each of the components of the velocity function with respect to time. And the derivative of 2t is just 2, so I end up with a 2i hat in the first term. And then in the second term, I get a 3t j hat. And the derivative of the 2 there vanishes. So this acceleration is a non-trivial function of time. It's not a constant with respect to time. There's still a t dependence in there. And when I evaluate the acceleration at t equals 0, I just sub in t equals 0 there, and the j hat term vanishes, and I end up with 2i hats. Again, I should probably write units on this, and again, that's meters per second squared. So at t equals 0, the particle happens to be accelerating exactly in the i hat direction with a magnitude of 2 meters per second squared. So here's a quick summary of what we've accomplished in this video. First, we started writing positions as vectors pointing from the origin to the location of the object. Second, we discovered that the instantaneous velocity of an object at any moment in time is given by simply taking the time derivative of the components of that position vector. And we could also write that as an x velocity I hat and a y velocity j hat. And then finally, we discovered that the acceleration vector at any moment in time is given by just taking another time derivative of those same components. So I got x double prime and y double prime as my components, or I could write it as an x acceleration I hat, y acceleration j hat. Our next order of business is to apply these ideas to solving the problem of projectile motion, and I'll post a link to that video in the end screen. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.